What led to the 1960s protest song? I'm of the opinion that it all started with African American spirituals. These arguably could be America's first protest songs. A great example of one of these songs is Go Down Moses, which was written around the 1800s. Here's a 1958 version by Louis Armstrong.
Yes, the Lord said, go down,
go down,
Moses,
Moses,
way
way
down
down.
In Egypt land, tell all the pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
This song references the biblical history of how Moses led the Israelites to freedom. God used Moses as a mouthpiece to communicate his will for the Israelite nation. Exodus 5:1. And afterward, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, "Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast unto me in the wilderness." This African American writer is asking the same thing of Moses again, to free his people, except this time they ask Moses to go down. Down quite obviously means down south, where slavery is still legal. The language in the song is metaphorical while also straightforward, a classic format for American protest songs, like, for example, Bob Dylan's Blowin' in the Wind. Dylan asks bluntly, "How many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man?" with the same severity that the spiritual writer commands Moses to tell old Pharaoh to let my people go. And Dylan at the chorus says, "The answer, my friend, is blowin' in the wind," a metaphor referring to the countercultural movement of the 60s. Just like the spiritual writer uses Egypt, the place the Israelites were enslaved, as a metaphor to describe the plight of enslaved African Americans. Go Down Moses did pave the way for later protest songs, but Go Down Moses, first and foremost, is an African American spiritual, next, an American folk song, then a protest song. At least, that's my opinion. So, yes, this song, while being a possible example of an American protest song, is in no way of the same formula of protest songs made in the 1960s. Because obviously, there's still a huge piece missing from this conversation. That piece is singer-songwriter folk music. It's difficult to understand the 1960s protest song if we don't have a brief understanding of the history of singer-songwriter American folk music. Before we had singer-songwriter American folk music, we just had roots American folk music. This came in many different forms: cowboy songs, Appalachian music, so like yodeling. And even Cajun music, a style derived from French-speaking Acadians in Canada. It was in the 20th century that individual Americans began to write songs based upon their own personalized suffering, and many of these were protest songs. It's hard to know exactly who wrote the first of these songs, but Joe Hill's The Preacher and the Slave is a great example of one of these songs.
Long-haired preachers come out every night, try to tell you what's wrong and what's right. But when asked about something to eat, they will answer with voices so sweet, you will eat by and by in that glorious land in the sky. Work and pray, live on hay. Get pie in the sky when you die.
That's a lie.
And the starvation army they play, and they sing and they clap and they pray, till they get all your coin on the drum. Then they tell you when you're on the bum.
But this song was never actually recorded by the Joe Hill, so although it lives on as a composition, listeners don't have the same emotional connection that they do to, say, John Prine, because they can't hear Joe Hill's actual voice singing to them through a recording. Woody Guthrie, along with Pete Seeger, Burl Ives, and others, was arguably one of the first recorded singer-songwriters to use the base of traditional American folk music and then write relevant lyrics that spoke to the suffering Americans were encountering in the present time. He did this especially in his most famous album entitled The Dust Bowl Ballads. Guthrie wrote this album during both the Great Depression and the Dust Bowl era of the 1930s. This album tells the story of a Midwesterner's journey to California, as during this time, California was the escape from both economic hardship and natural disaster. The songs written on this album were intensely relatable to folks living in this time because they spoke to the resilience of this working-class generation while also acknowledging the incredible despair and hopelessness that comes with living in such a tumultuous time. However, there are also explicit protest songs on this album. One of my personal favorites is Dust Can't Kill Me.
That old dust storm killed my baby, but it can't kill me, Lord, and it can't kill me. That old dust storm will kill my family, but it can't kill me, Lord, and it can't kill me.
The protest songs of Woody Guthrie's generation were basically poor, disenfranchised white guys singing about working class problems. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just we don't see a lot of focus on women's issues or race issues, which is obviously one of the most important ingredients in 1960s protest songs. However, that all changes in 1929 with Billie Holiday's release of Strange Fruit, written by Lewis Allen. This is a song commenting on the brutality of the lynchings of Black Americans. Jazz writer Leonard Feather says Strange Fruit was, quote, the first significant protest in words and music, the first unmuted cry against racism. The words by itself are incredibly powerful, but Billie Holiday's voice makes this song.
Southern trees bear strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the root, black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
If you've heard 1960s protest music, you know Strange Fruit is quite different from the more in-your-face, passionate lyrics of the 60s. But Billie Holiday's haunting voice quite effectively delivers this song directly into the gut of the listener. And Holiday, being Black herself, adds a whole new layer to this song because, for one of the first times in history, through song, a Black woman is given the opportunity to speak on the racism endured by her people. Strange Fruit plants the seed for the racially charged music of the 1960s. Before we get into that piece, let's make sure we understand the political and social climate of the early 1960s. Okay, there's a lot of history here, but let's just do a quick breakdown. The decade starts off with JFK being elected. JFK started his presidency out rough with the failed Bay of Pigs invasion. This was an attempt to destroy Fidel Castro's communist regime in Cuba. Under JFK's leadership, the US continued to make these attempts, and American troops continued to fail. Yeah, 1961 was not a great year for Americans. This changed in 1962 when JFK handled the Cuban Missile Crisis with grace. Meanwhile, racial tensions rose in southern states with the introduction of the Civil Rights Movement. On June 11, 1963, JFK delivers his Civil Rights Address, in which he said, quote, "This is one country. It has become one country because all of us and all the people who came here had an equal chance to develop their talents. We cannot say to 10% of the population that you can't have that right, that your children cannot have the chance to develop whatever talents they have, that the only way that they are going to get the rights is to go in the street and demonstrate. I think we owe them and we owe ourselves a better country than that." End quote. His VP, Lyndon Johnson, passes the Civil Rights Act of 1964, in which racial segregation was outlawed everywhere, schools, public places, and work areas. So that's the political climate. But what about the hippies? What about those weird, colorful buses that originated during this time? What about... Thank goodness, I won't be discussing that today. But of course, the countercultural movement rising in 1960s youth obviously had a big influence on music at the time. Art during the 60s was often countercultural indeed. Youth were rebelling against the conformist society their parents had raised them in. The youth were also rebelling against the racist and sexist status quo of the 1950s. The movement in the 60s ultimately went south, as things usually do in huge movements, leading to the sexual revolution and a lot of STDs. But hold the phone, we're talking about 1960s protest music, and while all this protest music was influenced by the youth counterculture of that time, the most important influence on protest music was the Vietnam War. During Kennedy's presidency, he greatly increased military aid, and by the time of his assassination, there were 16,000 American soldiers stationed in Vietnam. So, the best way to understand both protest musicians' opinion on the war and the straight facts of the war itself is to dive right into the music and era and take a look at Barry McGuire's Eve of Destruction. This song does a basic run-through of all the disturbing events going on during this time. Released in 1965, this song was an anthem for disillusioned youth of the 60s.
The Eastern world, it is exploding, violence flaring, bullets loading. You're old enough to kill, but not for voting. You don't believe in war, but what's that gun you're toting? And even the Jordan River has bodies floating. But you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, you don't believe we're on the eve of destruction.
I know, this song is heavy. You'd never guess that 6 years later, McGuire would become a born-again Christian. But anyway, the Eastern world refers to East Asia and Vietnam. At the time of this song's release, 18-year-olds could go off to war, but they couldn't vote or get married until they were 21. These lyrics condemn the U.S. for endorsing peace on earth and goodwill towards all men at one moment, and then, in another moment, send thousands of young American soldiers off to fight in a foreign war that doesn't need to be fought. The lyricist P.F. Sloan laments the lack of peace lost in all areas, even the sacred places, like the Jordan River, which during 1965 was a site for senseless violence in a series of battle confrontations between Israel and their Arab neighbors. The lyrics are both factual and poetic. The lyric line, quote, "Even the Jordan River has bodies floating," end quote, could work even if there wasn't a battle taking place on the Jordan River, because Americans could relate to those sacred elements of a culture being lost. Long story short, this song became such a smash hit because young Americans were sick of war, whether that be the war in Vietnam or the war going on in Israel. Youth culture agreed. War was horrible. This was the first protest song to hit number one on the Billboard Hot 100, making the protest song format popular. Funnily enough, this song was banned by radio, making it even more beloved by the youth. Youth began to suggest there was another way to fight. Through civic demonstration, through public outcry, and through songs like Eve of Destruction. Artists everywhere throughout the American nation began to fight through the use of art. There's a lot of great songs from the 1962 through 1964 protest era of music too, from Pete Seeger's classic We Shall Overcome to Sam Cooke's hopeful ballad A Change Is Gonna Come to the many songs written by Bob Dylan. It's impossible to talk about 1960s protest music without mentioning how influential Bob Dylan was to this era of American music. Dylan, heavily inspired by Woody Guthrie, formed his own stage persona after Guthrie's personality. His first song was written in 1962, a song called The Ballad of Emmett Till, written about a black boy who was shot and beaten to death after whistling at a white woman. This pattern continued for a while, with Dylan writing classic songs like The Times Are a-Changin', Blowin' in the Wind, and Only a Pawn in Their Game, until he became burned out by how political the 1960s folk movement was becoming. Nonetheless, Dylan formed and inspired an entire generation of songwriters desiring change. The protest music created after Dylan's leave took on a new flavor. Like we discussed earlier with Eve of Destruction, they were often anti-war anthems. 1965 through 1968 also saw a rise of indigenous and black songwriters rising up and writing their own protest songs, speaking to the racism in America. It's interesting because the reason these protest songs were being written was because of the desecration committed in the beginning of our nation's establishment. Racism in America started with the colonization of the Native American, it continued with enslavement of African peoples, continued with Native American boarding schools, continued with laws decreeing black Americans three-fifths human, continued with the segregation of whites and persons of color, and it still continues today through police brutality and much more. So, protest music really echoes back to those unresolved problems faced by minorities because of those first acts of racism. So, it was no surprise when in 1964, Buffy Sainte-Marie, a native, became pretty prominent in the American folk protest music movement because of her song, Universal Soldier. The act of resistance had been ingrained into her DNA. Sainte-Marie was born in Canada on a native reserve in Saskatchewan, but she was abandoned as an infant, so she was adopted and began her life in the States. So yeah, she's not Native American, but she is an indigenous North American, and her people faced the same forced assimilation that American Natives faced. There's a lot to say about Buffy Sainte-Marie's famous song, Universal Soldier. It was another classic song of the era, protesting war. The Universal Soldier refers to every soldier from anywhere who believes he is fighting for peace, yet, the lyrics seem to say, he is only inflicting more useless violence. The lyrics go,
he's the Universal Soldier, and he really is to blame. You see, this is not the way we put an end to war.
I'm not going to focus on this song that much because it has been dissected many times before, but I do want to further focus on a song Buffy did after Universal Soldier, as much of her work after this classic is forgotten by mainstream audiences. My Country, 'Tis of Thy People You're Dying is a song remembering the plight Native Americans faced during the establishment of the United States. It was one of the first protest songs that addressed the persecution Native people endured. The lyrics are confident and brutally honest. Released in 1966, this song was ahead of its time.
Now that your big eyes are finally opened, now that you're wondering how must they feel, meaning them that you've chased across America's movie screens. Now that you're wondering how can it be real that the ones you've called colorful, noble, and proud in your school propaganda, they starve in their splendor. You've asked for my comment, I simply will render. My country, 'tis of thy people you're dying.
This song, including Now That the Buffalo's Gone, pushed Buffy out of the limelight due to how controversial these issues were. For some reason, it was acceptable to acknowledge the racism inflicted on black Americans, but it was unacceptable to acknowledge that Native people went through the same racism. Songs like Buffy's were a preface to the Native resistance that was coming. In 1968, the American Indian Movement was formed as a response to recent acts of police brutality in Minneapolis, Minnesota. What followed was a series of occupations and marches. These gatherings protested the US government's mistreatment of Native Americans. But we're getting a little ahead of ourselves. In 1966, the year Buffy Sainte-Marie released My Country, 'Tis of Thy People You're Dying, the Vietnam War was still in full swing. The most important protest song of 1966 was Shirley Donovan's The War Drags On. Listen to these lyrics.
Last night, poor Don had a nightmare, it seemed. One kept occurring and reoccurring in his dreams. cities full of people burning, screaming, shouting loud. And right there overhead, a great orange mushroom cloud.
This song reflects the common despair faced by Americans, especially the youth, as they saw more and more young men being drafted into war without a sign of victory in sight. It seems like the writer, Donovan, was actually in the war, as the lyrics do explain what it was like to be an American soldier in Vietnam. The reason this is so is because in 1966, 93% of Americans had a television set. Donovan was able to base his lyrics off of what everyone else was seeing on television, causing a great deal of people to relate to the message of the war drags on. Without the influence of television, there probably wouldn't have been such a massive anti-war movement. But because the average American was seeing an everyday realistic glimpse into how war actually was, there was an unavoidable negative reaction towards sending young boys off to fight in a war that had nothing to do directly with the United States. But as the war dragged on, some Americans began to sympathize with the Vietnamese over or on the same level as American troops. We can see the sympathy in Joan Baez's 1967 song, Saigon Bride.
Farewell, my wistful Saigon bride. I'm going out to stem the tide, a tide which never saw the seas. It flows through jungles around the trees. Some say it's yellow, some say red. It will not matter when we're dead.
Protest music continued to surge throughout the end of the 60s and into 1971. We see a lot of the same themes here. War is bad.
Yeah. What is it good for?
Absolutely.
Racism is bad.
Yeah. Some people say we got a lot of malice. Some say it's a lot of nerve. But I say we won't quit moving until we get what we deserve. We've been built and we've been scorned. We've been treated bad, talked about as sure as you born. But just as sure as it takes 2 eyes to make a pair.
And if we don't stop these problems, we're all gonna die.
And it's 1, 2, 3. What are we fighting for? Don't ask me, I don't give a damn. The next stop is Vietnam. And it's 5, 6, 7. Open up the pearly gates. Well, there ain't no time to wonder why. Woo-hoo, we're all gonna die.
As the years went on, the trend of protest music began to die out, and eventually, the U.S. withdrew American troops from the Vietnam War in 1975. In conclusion, 1960s protest music brought American problems into the foreground of pop music, forcing American leaders to bring about change, whether they were ready or not. These protest songs are ingrained into our nation. It was just last week that my friend played Blowin' in the Wind in her car as we were driving. My hope is that we will learn these songs and, in turn, understand them. 1960s protest songs remind us of what we have accomplished and how far we still need to go as a nation. We must not despair and remember that, as humans, we can't solve these problems on our own. Jesus is the light that the world needs. Thank you for watching this video. I make all my videos for my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is the Redeemer. I will see you all soon.